Information about Canada's housing market. Housing starts, the slowest pace of breaking ground since September 2020. At the same time across the country, home sales are moving up. Prices are advancing month to month. This is the Bank of Canada doing what it can to deal with the demand side by going back to increasing interest rates. Let's bring in Barry Fenton, President and CEO of Lanterra Developments. You're a builder, you're a landlord, you have got a lot of skin in this game. So there's a lot of ways that we could take this. I'd love to just get your view on what you think that going back to rate hikes by the Bank of Canada is going to do to the market activity.
I think we were doing so well up until about 2 weeks ago when people thought that there wasn't going to be another increase. We're now at prime at 6.95. So I think the market got a little wobbly because people just want certainty. So I think overall we're going to be fine. You can see the way banks are pricing in longer term financings, and they're substantially less than where they should be. So I think we're going to be good. I think once we have one more rate increase, which I think will happen maybe by the summertime, I think the barn door is going to be open and lots of horses running around.
And it sounds like rates are not the restraining factor that we think it should be, right? Because it should be the most sensitive to the housing market, or the housing market should be the most sensitive to it. And it's not because of what? Psychology, just thirst, demand for
Well,
homes?
I think it's just, again, I actually believe that people make their decisions based on certainty. So when they think that there's uncertainty, they get a little nervous. But I can tell you that there's over 1 million people that came into Canada over the last year. No one came in with a house on their back. So there's a housing request, there's demand, there's going to be slowdown with respect to developers not sure whether they should launch new projects or not, or go ahead. I think it's just, you know, every time I come on, it's like a 45 record that keeps repeating itself. We're good. We are very good. I'm not happy with the way, to be honest, with the way the governor of Canada has quite managed the interest rate hikes, because he kind of put us in the spot from where we were 3 years ago when interest, you know, when prime was substantially lower. But it's a good story, and we have an asset class that can weather any storm better than any other class of asset.
I mean, you're not worried about your overall sector, which I guess is a good thing as a business owner. But you mentioned that maybe at the margins, are you rethinking some developments? Have you pulled back on places that you want to develop, erecting new buildings? What's gone on in this rising rate environment for you?
Well, we're all go ahead. Are we more cautious? Well, what we're doing now is we are redusting off our pro formas to make sure that we can manage increase in construction costs. When we built our projects from 3-4 years ago, which we completed in the last year, for example, we were carrying interest rate components at 3%, not at 7%. So there's no effect that it hit the bottom line. I mean, I can't be unrealistic about it. We also had trade costs that went up from where they were supposed to be. But we still carry nice contingencies, and we're okay making with what we're making. So I think long-term and short-term, we just acquired another large site downtown Toronto that we closed on 2 months ago. It's substantial, so we're still bullish, very bullish.
And is it greenfields or something's already
it's
there?
It's something close to City Hall,
okay.
But it's so I'm not sure I would call that greenfield, but it's substantial downtown.
Yeah, I know there's not a lot of greenfield, but I guess is it something that you can convert? Was it an office space?
No. It's a residential.
Okay.
Residential. Right now there isn't much on it, but there will be shortly. But, you know, we also own office buildings in downtown Toronto, and that's another whole topic, you know, that we could get into about where the office market looks and how it's going to play out.
Let's get into it then. You know, I walk around the financial center, I go to people's offices, and it's pretty empty.
That it is, but on the buildings that I'm involved in, the vacancy rates may be higher, but the tenants are still paying rent.
Well, for now, but
I think we're through the worst of where we should be. I think what we're also looking at doing, we have some a few assets that are down by the Yonge and King area, and what we're thinking of doing now is going in for rezonings for residential, which I think is a good play. And I did that whole concept with my partner back in the early 2000s when we took all of the land between the Air Canada Centre and the Sky Dome. we created a whole new area of residential, hotels, some office. And at the time, you were only allowed to build office. So what's happening now is in certain areas of downtown Toronto where people own office buildings, they may have a challenge in trying to convince the city officials to allow them to go from office zoning to residential. Mm-hmm. But once they can get their heads around that, you're going to see a lot. You may see a lot of conversions. I also don't think that the office market is as bad as everyone thinks it's going to be, is.
So we also had the CEO of Tridel, another condo developer, on, and he said one of the problems with this, what you're talking about, converting office to residential, is the rezoning. It takes forever, so bureaucratic. And then two, people think you can't just do that with office. There's all kinds of residential zoning requirements, or codes, I should say, you know, the distance of the windows to the hallway, bathrooms, plumbing, that's not just a flip of the switch.
I know who it was because I thought he's a very brilliant representative of the housing competitor of ours. They're good people. But I think that, if you have a piece of land, you can make it work. I think that maybe what he was referencing perhaps is reconverting the office component into, like, stripping out the office component and rebuilding it as a residential. That may be a little bit different. But I think overall, if you have a piece of land and you have to abide by certain setbacks, you can make it work. I'm not sure, like, if you're starting from, really a couple
scratch,
of concepts.
Yes.
You can take an office building and tear it down and start, and, you know, you have a new canvas, or you can take an office building in place, strip it out, and go to residential and add floors. I mean, there's lots of different things you can do.
And how long does that take to play up?
You're probably looking at a 2 to 3 year zoning process.
Zoning?
Rezoning.
Rezoning?
Right.
Okay, that's
right.
A long
from
time.
From when you start to, yeah, but I mean, it depends on what you're doing. In certain areas, if you're just taking an office building and reconverting it to residential and you're allowed to have a certain square footage of area, it's not going to take that long.
The fact remains, the stat that has been lingering with me is we need to build more homes in the next 10 years than we've built in the last 30 years. And there's a lot of political posturing kind of at every level of government. Are you seeing anything concrete that will get us to that destination?
Well, I think that what you're going to see is more push out to allowing areas of development outside downtown Toronto, for example. But you are right. I mean, the housing component is, there's so much demand and there's not enough supply. And I'm not really quite, it's like going to a shoemaker and asking him to take a size 10 and convert it into a size 6. I'm not sure I really have the full answer on it, but I do know that it's a great model and we're just going to have to keep chipping away at it.
What about introducing, I guess, more creative legislation to temper the demand side? An economist I was speaking to, an Asian economist, said, you know, if you look at what Singapore did on the land transfer tax, they introduced, I think it was like 40% if you're a second home buyer, or if you're buying for a second home, or 60% if you're a foreign buyer on land transfer, and that has an immediate kind of effect on those that are maybe at the margins driving up prices. Do you think that that would be meaningful this point?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Why?
They haven't. I mean, they did do this land transfer tax component foreign tax where they said, or then they actually said foreigners can't purchase. It didn't cause the market to come down or come up. The thing you need to do now is the city, and I've been talking to the city officials, and I know people in the provincial side, and what we need to do is incentivize the condo development community to be able to build more affordable housing potentially. And it's not by doing 10% of every building has to be at a cheaper rate. That's not going to work.
Why?
Because you end up subsidizing it by charging more to the other 90% because you can't finance it properly. So it does become a problem. So I think what you need to do is that we need to have more incentives. We need to have the government provide incentives to developers. But the truth of it is, even if we put out another 2 million condos, or square, 2 million units in the next 3 to 5 years, it's still not going to deal with the supply-demand issue. So I'm not quite sure. I mean, they're trying to fix a problem that really is not fixable because people want housing. People love the classification the class of housing, and it's a great asset to own it. So I'm not sure. I mean, I think we're in it. I think it's something that we're always going to talk about every day about housing. But I think it's I think it's a reality check.
It's also so different to be talking about this because at one point people were talking about Canada's housing market due for a crash, counting all the cranes that were in Toronto, you being a lot of those cranes out there. What happened to that?
Well, now we're talking about the U.S. and their crashes and their office. I read an article today about some office components, like the secondary offices having issues with respect to the secondary banks. Look, I think that people like to talk about it. It's interesting. I'll leave you on this note. Why are we talking about housing so much? It's because it's an important classification, and people need housing. So it's always going to be the chatter. And I think we're really in good shape. I think that I'm nervous now in the sense that I think that once rates start to come down, I think the market's going to go nuts. So.